Good evening and welcome from Bedford Square and the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art for the second in a series of talks by authors of books recently published by the Paul Mellon Centre. I'm Martin Myrone, convener of the British Art Network based here at the Paul Mellon Centre, and I'm pleased to be the chair this evening for presentations and conversation around two recent PMC publications, Henrietta McBurney's Illuminating Natural History and Joseph Viscomi's William Blake's Printed Paintings, which you can see behind me here, hopefully. The two authors have been invited to talk for about 20 minutes each about their books, sharing something about the genesis of their project, their aims and ambitions. We will then have some time for conversation, prompted by questions that we hope you, the audience, will submit. This evening's event is fully online, and I'm sure you are all familiar with the webinar format. But just to be sure, we've got a housekeeping slide, which is hopefully coming up. Yeah. You should enter your questions for the speakers using the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. You should see it in the menu at the bottom. I will then be able to pick up questions and relay them during the discussion section at the end. The chat function will remain open, but shouldn't be used for questions to the speakers primarily. I mean, that's a kind of, it's chat, but for questions that you want put to the speakers, use the Q&A function. The session will be recorded and made available to the public. And do note that closed captioning is available. Click the CC button, again, the menu at the bottom, to enable captions. But now, straight on to our first speaker. Henrietta McBurney is a freelance curator and art historian whose interests include natural history illustration, material culture, the history of collections and portraiture. Henrietta was formerly curator in the Royal Library Windsor Castle and has also held curatorial roles at Eton College, the Garrick Club, Newnham College, Cambridge. Her publications include studies on the botanical illustrations of Alexander Marshall, found in the only known flower book painted by an English artist in the 17th century, and the natural history drawings for the Paper Museum compiled by the 17th century Roman collector Cassiano del Pozzo. Henrietta's interests in the intersection of art and science are very much apparent in her most recent publication, Illuminating Natural History, the Art and Science of Mark Catesby, which she will be discussing this evening under the title Catesby's Artistry. Henrietta.
Thank you, Martin.
And we're seeing that well. Thanks very much, Henrietta.
Good. Well, thank you very much to Martin and my Paul Mellon Centre colleagues. In my book on Mark Catesby, I include a chapter on Catesby as artist. In this talk, I want to give a particular inflection to the word artist by using the term artistry, by which I mean the craftsmanship of Catesby's art, the technicalities and techniques or processes by which he made the illustrations of the natural world. Joseph Viscomi uses several words or phrases to describe Blake's illustrations that could equally be used of Catesby's. He speaks of Blake's energy and creativity, imagination and restlessness, and improvisation. I would like to add that both illustrators used experimental techniques and that both were highly individual. Colour was also a significant element of their work as designers and printmakers. I will address the concept of Catesby's artistry under three heads: Catesby as designer, Catesby as printmaker, and in the last section, which I've called Catesby as borrower, I want to reflect on the idea of copying and reusing. Catesby was highly esteemed by his contemporaries for his watercolours of plants and animals. He left several statements about his work. As I was not bred a painter, I hope some faults in perspective and other niceties may be more readily excused. From this, we learn that Catesby was a gentleman amateur. In other words, he had no professional training. I was not bred a painter. Rather, he taught himself in the usual way of the time, from artists' manuals and from copying prints and other artists' work. His watercolours and drawings were made mainly during his two expeditions to America, to Virginia between 1712 and 1719, and to South Carolina and the Bahama Islands between 1722 and 1726. Most of these watercolours were used as models for his Natural History of Carolina, Florida, and the Bahama Islands, a monumental work published by subscription in 11 parts between 1729 and 1747. When I first encountered Catesby's original watercolours in the 1980s in the Royal Library at Windsor Castle, they were mounted into a unique copy of his book. The copy had been bought by George III in 1768, but instead of the usual two volumes, there were three. And instead of the usual hand-coloured etched plates, the copy contained Catesby's and other artists' original drawings and watercolours. Because there were more drawings than etched plates, they had spread out of two into three volumes. A few years after I first saw them, the drawings were lifted from the volumes for their long-term preservation. The individual drawing sheets were then mounted and housed in boxes in the air-conditioned print room at Windsor. This was the room designed by Prince Albert, specifically to house the royal collection of prints and drawings. In the process of lifting the drawings, we discovered a significant number of other drawings on the backs of the sheets, what we call the versos. These were, in effect, Catesby's discarded drawings. They had been hidden for view for almost 2.5 centuries. In the 18th century, paper was expensive, so it was usual for draftsmen to use both sides of the sheet. These abandoned drawings consisted mainly of preliminary sketches or field studies. As you can imagine, uncovering them was an exciting moment. It provided fascinating glimpse into the processes involved in Catesby making his finished watercolours. It also became a piece of detective work to try and match up the sketches with the finished drawings. It never occurred to me at this point that I was beginning on a piece of research that would one day turn into a book. Some of the drawings we found were simple pen and ink outlines or compositional sketches such as these. Some sketches and others had details finished in watercolour, such as these. Some sketches presented puzzles. The faint outline, a strange long-beaked and long-necked bird seemed rather like a doodle or a caricature. But could it perhaps have been a first idea for Catesby's great blue heron? The faint outline of a fox on another sheet puzzled me, as there was no equivalent finished drawing in Catesby's book. Other sketches were easy to match up with finished drawings. The outline of the lizard, drawn very lightly in graphite to the pen and ink drawing of the plant, later appears fully worked up in the finished watercolour on the right. Catesby not only added outlines of drawings to other drawings, he also cut up sheets and collaged elements onto different sheets. Here he is clearly experimenting with his composition. The snake was cut out of another sheet and pasted over the corner of this plant drawing. In the print, it's shown more convincingly curled up behind the plant stalk. Catesby believed that colour was essential to recording nature. He wrote, "The illuminating of natural history is so important to a perfect understanding of it that I may aver a clearer idea may be conceived from the figures of animals and plants in their proper colours than from the most exact description without them." The verb illuminating functions on several levels. On the level of artistry, it means painting very exactly in the tradition of illuminated manuscripts. But surely Catesby also intended it to mean that through art, he was shining a light on or revealing the natural world. What is clear from his statement is that his art was in the service of natural history. He created his images to perfect an understanding of the natural world, In other words, he came to art as a naturalist. Painting equipment was rather more cumbersome in Catesby's day. Handy watercolour boxes with cakes of pigment needing only water to dilute them didn't exist. Artists bought raw or ready ground pigments from apothecaries and colour shops. These had to be mixed on the spot with a medium, such as gum arabic, and then diluted with water. Mussel or oyster shells were often used as mixing palettes, as you can see in this lady painting in Sandby's watercolour. Catesby, in common with other artists, made some of his own colours, especially when they were expensive to buy, as was carmine, the purple-red pigment made from cochineal insects. Catesby describes gathering these beetles off the prickly pear cactus, a laborious and messy process. He discovered that it was not always easy to capture and reproduce the colours of nature. Fishes had to be painted quickly once out of water before they faded. In this case of the hogfish, I think we can agree he was rather successful. Other groups of animals, such as amphibia, reptiles, crustacea, and insects, were easier, especially if they could be preserved without fading or kept in captivity and studied up close. In these details, you can see Catesby handling pigment in different ways with different brush strokes to describe a range of textures and markings of these animals. As a naturalist in the field, Catesby observed the interaction and interdependence of plants and animals. As an artist, he used colour as well as shape and form to underline what we would now call environmental or ecological connections. He saw the Baltimore oriole nesting in the tulip tree. The connection between bird and tree is mirrored in the shared colours and also in the shape of the bird's breast and the lower part of the flower petals. In the right-hand composition, the oval fruit and its mixture of green, pink and yellow colours are likewise reflected in the breast of the bird. As a designer, Catesby was never static. He was restless in his search for connections and juxtapositions. When Catesby returned from his travels in America in 1726, he brought with him between 200 and 300 watercolours. These designs were the preparatory stage for the printed illustrations in his book. He planned to have them engraved on the continent where the best engravers were working, but lack of funds for such an expensive procedure meant he had to become his own printmaker. Not surprisingly, he chose to etch rather than engrave his drawings. The technique of etching using a needle to draw the design through a wax layer directly onto the copper plate, the lines of which were then bitten by acid, was similar to drawing, whereas engraving using a burin demanded greater time and expertise. Catesby learned the technique of etching from the foremost etcher of the day, the French artist Joseph Goupy. He recorded that it was under Goupy's kind advice and instructions that I undertook and was initiated in the way of etching myself. Goupy made his name by copying the works of old masters and with a series of etched landscapes made after other artists' paintings. His prints, influenced by the romantic landscapes of Salvador Rosa, were known for their freedom and spirit. While the etching technique was simple compared to engraving, it nonetheless involved elaborate stages and much equipment, as shown in this view of an etcher and engraver studio. Among the many activities going on here, you can see several different methods for using acid to bite the etch lines into the copper plate, pouring it over the plate and immersing the plate in an acid bath. It took experience to master the techniques, for example, the length of time to leave the etched copper plate in the acid bath to produce the exact quality of lightness or darkness of the line required. It's worth noting that the naturalist Alexander Wilson gave up trying to etch his own drawings after one attempt and handed the task on to a professional. By contrast, Catesby mastered the different skills and became a fluent etcher. The landscape on the left demonstrates four different levels of biting. with the faintest lines for the furthest background and the darkest for the vegetation in the near foreground, marked O. The details in these two etchings of Catesby's on the right show him applying these rules to show the ship in the far distance and the rock so that it fades into the background. Catesby wrote that he chose to etch not in a graver-like manner, but choosing rather to omit the method of cross-hatching and to follow the humour of the feathers, which is more laborious and I hope has proved more to the purpose. While Goopy had taught Catesby the technical requirements of etching, Goopy himself did not produce natural history illustrations. Instead, Catesby looked to the work of a 17th century artist, Francis Barlow, to learn how to convey the texture of plumage and fur in a naturalistic way. Barlow had produced a well-known series of etched illustrations of animals for his edition of Aesop's Fables in 1667. His book became a model for professional as well as amateur artists and was to run to four editions. Barlow was not acknowledged by Catesby in his book, but he was to influence his work in a number of ways, as we will see shortly. The uncoloured print of the little owl is a clear example of what Catesby described as the humour of the feathers. In the print of the summer duck, the different techniques of plumage are enhanced by the colouring. However, there was always a danger that colourists might obscure the etched lines, as has happened in the black and white striped area in this print. In these two etchings, Catesby conveys in a remarkable way the difference between the soft fur of the flying squirrel and the wiry hair of the skunk. The etching stage for Catesby was not simply a reproductive process. It provided a further stage to continue working on the narrative details of his illustrations. In these two plates, he adds a whole layer of information to his primary drawings, a tumble-down barn structure for the purple martin and the hole dug by the turtle to lay its eggs. These are examples of Catesby's inventiveness in his etchings, a cartouche for a map with its elements ingeniously made out of seashells and coral, and the headpiece to his account of Carolina and the Bahama Islands, constructed out of Native American ethnographic artifacts, including weapons, cooking utensils, a smoking pipe, and a string of beads. Although he never signed his drawings, Catesby added monograms to many of his etchings. These are further examples of his imaginative invention. His entwined initials, MC, become part of the organic design of many of his prints. Here we have dangling spiders, the prey of a fish, and flourishes on the end of torn off stems and coral. Catesby's expressive calligraphic line may have been developed from his use of writing manuals such as this one above. The 18th century was a period characterized by borrowing, adapting, and repurposing, not just in visual art and architecture, but notably, for example, in music. Catesby's close contemporaries, Handel, whom he may have met through Goopy, and Bach and Telemann are well-known examples of composers who repurposed other composers' work as well as their own. In a similar way, Catesby borrowed from other artists' work. His reuse of other artistic sources is striking and even on occasion surprising. While sometimes his borrowings may have been unconscious, at other times he interwove parts of other artists' work into his own designs. Sometimes he used their work wholesale. Catesby was familiar not only with other artists' engraved illustrations, but also with original natural history drawings. After his return from America, he consulted the albums of coloured natural history drawings, or books of miniature, that Sir Hans Sloane was collecting for his museum. Trying to connect some of the sketches on the versos of Catesby's sheets with finished drawings took me to the British Museum, where Sloane's drawing albums are kept. This, for me, was like discovering a treasure trove of images, just as it must have been for Catesby almost 300 years ago. One moment of revelation was finding the origin of the elusive fox. Here is Catesby's prototype by an unidentified artist in an album entitled Quadrupeds. Catesby found several models from this album. Some of these were animals he had not been able to get close to in the wild. Some he appears to have considered better drawings than his own, and some were of animals he may not have seen at all. The white fox was not included in his book, but the grey fox was. In this instance, Catesby seemed to have copied rather than praised his model, as you can see by the different shape of the tail, and he adapted the colouring to suit his purpose. In his final composition, he also combines the illustrations of the fox with the Indian pink, somewhat out of scale. Sloane's Quadrupeds volume included this drawing of an American bison by the Dutch artist Everard Kick. Catesby recorded in his description of the bison that, having then by me only a sketch of the animal, which I thought not sufficient to make a true figure from, I have since been enabled to exhibit a perfect likeness of this awful creature. It was Kick's drawing that supplied the perfect likeness. He had seen the bison in the wild, feeding off the locust tree, and here he experiments with making the connection between the animal and its food source by ingeniously arranging the stem of the tree as if to show the bison leaping through it. Catesby encountered many rattlesnakes while he was in America, dead and alive, and must surely have made drawings of them. However, rather than use one of his own drawings, he chose to copy, possibly even trace, this watercolour by the 17th century French court artist Nicolas Robert. In his version, he adds a few of his own details to the borrowed image, very likely made from his own observations. The fang, the rattle seen from above and in cross section. And here they are again in his etching. So we have seen that borrowing could mean copying wholesale or even tracing. At other times, it involved repurposing other artists' work in different ways. Catesby admitted that he had some difficulties with perspective and other niceties. Again, he turned to Francis Barlow's Aesop's Fables, which this time provided him with models for illustrating birds in lifelike poses. The pose of Catesby's bald-headed eagle swooping to catch a fish dropped by the osprey is taken from Barlow's Hawk. And the osprey itself seems to be a very close copy, if not a tracing, from Barlow's Kite and Frog and Mouse illustration. For his image of his red-winged starling, Catesby adapted the same swooping pose of the hawk again. It seems that Catesby couldn't resist the urge to keep adding new elements to his plates. Still borrowing from Barlow, he enlivened his compositions with delightful miniature details taken from several of Aesop's illustrations. A miniature toad found crouching in the corner of Aesop's The Ox and Toad reappears, hiding amongst the weeds in the background for his brown bittern. Starfish and some shells scattered by the beached dolphin are scattered on the shoreline of his flamingo. I end with an example of Catesby reusing another artist's work wholesale. We have seen several examples of him repurposing drawings and prints by other artists and integrating them with elements of his own compositions to create new and original works. However, with this drawing of the cacao tree by the French artist Aubrier, he etched his model practically unaltered. Not only that, but he signed his print prominently and wittily with his monogram hanging from a leaf. This raises several questions. Is Catesby here suggesting that in the very act of making a print out of a drawing, he is creating an original work of art? If so, what does the concept of originality mean to him? I mentioned earlier that he never signed his drawings. Unlike some contemporary natural history artists, such as his friends Eret and Edwards. And apart from his acknowledging Joseph Goupy as his etching teacher, Catesby names no other artists in his book. Of course, we must remember that in his day, the concepts of status, identity, and ownership, or intellectual property, were at a very different point of development. Thanks largely to Hogarth, the Engraver's Copyright Act was passed in 1735, while Catesby was halfway through his book. But this was made specifically in respect of the designers of engravings rather than drawings or paintings. These perhaps are some thoughts for consideration later. Meanwhile, I'll end with Catesby's own comment about his art, in which he situates it in the wider context in which he made it. However accurately human art may be exercised in the representation of animals and plants, it falls far short of that inimitable perfection so visible in nature itself. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I don't know if you would have had a chance to look in the chat, but already lots of comments coming through about what a fantastic range of images you're showing and so much of interest that you have to say. And just to stress that the book itself is just kind of sumptuous with these extraordinary and striking images. So thank you so much. We'll return to some of these thoughts and questions that you're putting out there in the discussion towards the end of this evening. Do please enter questions in the Q&A box. I can see some are coming through already, and we'll get through as many as we can. I'm sure there's a lot to talk about. And also, if you haven't had a chance, do look in the chat, because it's telling, amongst other things, of how we have a global audience tonight. I think there's around 150 people attending, and they are from all corners of the world, from Florence and Montreal to Guildford and Wolverhampton, which I think is quite a spread, really, isn't it? I think some places are rainier than others, looking at the messages there. And indeed, our second speaker this evening is in the US at the moment and is joining us from there. Joseph Viscomi is James G. Keegan Distinguished Professor of English Literature at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And I think, Joe, you're in the office at the moment. So yes. Welcome. He is the author of numerous important studies of William Blake and the Romantic period, including the seminal Blake and the Idea of the Book, published by Princeton in 1993, and more recently, a very substantial essay on Blake's afterlife and the posthumous printings of his illuminated books in Blake and Illustrated Quarterly, 2019. He's also the co-editor and co-creator with Robert Essick and Morris Eves of the William Blake Archive, a hypermedia digital database of Blake's poetry and art. And it's an incredible resource which has transformed the field. And even if you don't think you're interested in Blake, check out this is a kind of an online resource and what it shows about the potential of the digital archive. This evening, Joe will be talking about his book, William Blake's Printed Paintings, Methods, Origins, Meaning, which examines Blake's 12 large colored prints of 1795. His presentation is entitled Illustrations or Paintings? So over to you, Joe.
Thank you. Thank you for your kind words. I have two teenage daughters who remind me how little I know. So it's nice to know that I used to know something. We'll see if I still do. I'm going to pull this over into a shared screen and see if all this works correctly. It's not moving. Let's see. Shared screen.
Don't worry, it takes a moment, Joseph. It worked earlier, so.
Yeah, here it is. Okay, now let's see if we can share that.
Yeah, that's really well.
Launch meeting, are you seeing it?
Yep, we're seeing it.
Well, I'm not, I'm seeing it on the wrong screen.
Oh, that would be confusing.
All right. You can see it?
See it, but take your time if you want to switch screens. That's absolutely fine.
Okay. Yes, you can see it?
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. What I'm going to do is try to answer this question. These questions were key to my research. And I'm going to start by looking at a poem. Look for clues, actually, from the Illuminated books. This is a poem by Blake. This is what the original looks like. And we can see that in its translation into type, a lot of information is lost. We're looking at something completely different than the type. The type is a copy. The original provides so much more information. But what is this that we're looking at? We know it's a print, but a contemporary viewer would not. There's no sign here that this is a print. You get that sign when you turn the page or you actually see the original and it's misregistered and you say, okay, well, this is some kind of print. There's a registration involved. And then we know that it's a print because we know there's other copies, early copies, later copies. But in none of these do we see signs of print, no plate marks, no evidence of metal tools. Indeed, what we're looking at is something calligraphic. We're looking at a brush mark with that's been etched with an etching needle to create white and black lines. We got that technique in here from wood engraving, a mass of black etched with a graver or a needle. And clearly here we have a quill. So what are we looking at? And we're seeing something in here in the background. And we can see that Blake can move from printing this image to creating a drawing that functions really as a printed manuscript, that oxymoron, because each time he prints it, we see each one is unique. Blake has a printable matrix, but he doesn't adhere to the convention of the repeatable image at all. So he's really breaking form there. And we can see here in these shallows that this is some kind of relief plate. And in a relief plate, Blake is writing with an impervious liquid impervious to acid. Here's nitric acid. And so what we're doing is creating a printable design on a copper plate. And you can see that each time he prints it, he does something a little different to it. So we know it's a relief plate. And then around 1794, he starts printing relief more shallowly, really with the intention of putting colors. This is already invented with the idea of color printing colors from both surfaces. Here you see color coming from the plateau, and you see he's defining form not by lines so much as plateaus and a cavity, negative space, a cavity within a mass. And here you see he's printing the color. Here, this is important. We'll come back to what we're seeing here between the reticulated colors that are printed and the flat color of the paper. What I want to see is what goes on when you print colors from the shallows and with the relief simultaneously. And you can see what's happening. Every time you do that, you create this halo along the edge of the relief line. And you can also see that color printing for Blake and anyone really is at least a two-stage process. You can transfer colors from a plate or any matrix to paper, but you then have to finish it in watercolors. And you see that very clearly here. Printed, here's our halo. Note the yellow, that's the paper. This is an attempt to finish. He never did finish this. This is a second pull. That means it's been pulled from this plate without replenishing the ink. And we see here in this test plate, the halo effect, what's causing it. The dabber or the brush or whatever you're using to apply the ink and color isn't picking up, isn't getting at the sides of the relief lines. And so here in this book of Thel, we see it very clearly. One, this is one ink, black, but it's creating that halo effect. Now we're doing this because I want to know what this monoprint is. Is it a relief plate? It has all the telltale signs of a shallow relief outline. There it is. We're seeing it right here. There's that yellow of the paper. We're seeing the halo all along the relief line. And in the second pull, we see it again. And we know this is metal. I knew it was metal because it has a plate mark. And this is a very interesting plate mark because it's on the verso of the plate. So this is a metal plate with an outline printed in shallow, a very low relief. This is its second pull. And this is clearly not a third pull. It's a separate impression. He cleaned the plate and he printed it again. And when he printed it again, he made sure not to make those mistakes of the halo effect. Now, another clue from other illuminated book is here. This is going this way. Okay, no problem. First pull, second pull. But this is not this. This is, so we're not looking at a relief line and we're not looking at an etch line. We're looking at something that has been printed planographically, painted on the plate and printed and each time it was painted anew. And there's something here that's important. We see these lines. And what we're looking at is the striated effect of gesso on a millboard. Blake moves from metal to millboard. And you can cover that effect with the first pull because the color is thick. But it shows up in the second pull. And if you try getting a third pull, you're getting a poor impression, but you're seeing the gesso ground very clearly. And you can see from the test what I'm doing here. The color looks thicker than it actually is because it's carrying that look of the three-dimensional gesso ground. And the ground is here. The colors can go wherever they want. Now, what we have is metal, and we have striations. Then we have these two plates that have neither any relief sign, any sign of metal, but they have no sign of gesso and they have no sign of relief. And so what they do have is exact size. They are the exact size of this one. And so we see Blake starting his experiments with this one and realizing that he doesn't need to etch a low relief outline. He can draw directly on an unetched plate. Now these are unetched metal and they're the exact same size as this, which means we saw that plate mark, which was the verso, that one of these is probably the recto of this copper plate. Blake did this all the time, very unorthodox to print, to etch on both sides, but he got away with it in relief etching. And when he went to the coppersmith to get two new plates with his new exciting project in mind of monoprinting earlier works, he bought two plates, maybe three, but I suspect he just bought two and he hedged his bet by etching the background, the verso of the first one. So here's the pattern of production. We get one, a second impression. The second work is Ilom, but there's one missing. The pattern of production is when he prints for the first time the design, he has two pulls at least. When he does three pulls, as in Satan, this one's missing. We know he's printed two. This is very bad third pull. You see the leg here is missing. There's very little ink or color left. And the fourth and fifth impressions, he tries to eke out three impressions. And here's where that takes him. Very little color left. Here he's missing the head of the horse. He can't get third pools. And by the next time, he doesn't try. He just prints two. He returns to the one much later and he refinishes it in 1805 and makes really a different painting altogether. The same with Nebuchadnezzar. And then he redid this in 1805. Newton, this one's missing. This is clearly a second pull, I think, because it's so flat. There's not much color transferring here from the plate. And the bottom one is 1805. Again, the pattern of production here is print one, second pull. Now, the second pull is not a copy. These are all originals. You can't say this is a copy of this. This is a second unique pull with its own variants. And when he comes back to it, he cleans the plate and he prints it anew, and that's a separate pull. And you have the same pattern of production here. And here, you don't have any third printing or third pull. These were the last two monoprints. So we have three printings. That second one, Elijah, House of Death, Hectic, and a later one. Now, this is important, 1805. This was discovered by Martin Butlin and his Tate conservators when they examined their copy of Newton. They found an 1804 watermark, which is proof that these are monoprints and not monotypes. A monotype is without a printable matrix. A monoprint is a unique impression from a printable matrix. So we know he could return to it at any time and reprint it. Now, the most important thing is here. First nine designs are modeled on earlier work. That's the clue we need to answer our question. One, two, three, four. And here is Blake going to his own portfolio, his own repository of designs, a watercolor, a sketch in the notebook, another sketch in the notebook, another wash drawing. He's going back to his own earlier works and looking for images to recreate in this really cool new process. Pitti has small Pitti as its earlier model, and it had the second of the Pitti drawings as its model. We see the same going back to a little vignette in Marriage. Nebuchadnezzar does the same, Marriage of Heaven and Hell. Notebook. You see what Blake is doing. He's not inventing yet for the medium. He's using the medium to reinvent works already executed in other medium, none of which are illustrations of his prophecies. They all they're in diverse media, executed at different times. This is the only preliminary to a monoprint, 1795 drawing of Hecate. That's it. I mean, that one was done for this new medium. These two do not have any design of any kind, notebook or anywhere else. So he's really doing these interesting melodramatic domestic scenes for the medium itself. Now, this is the most important earlier work. Elijah in the chariot of fire. I mean, that's what the iconography tells us this is. He amplifies that iconography when he recreates it as a monoprint. But in 1805, when he prepared eight monoprints for Thomas Butts, six from the 1795 printing and two he reprinted for him in 1805 on that 1804 water paper, he wrote titles in pencil underneath the paper. It's imperial size paper, and he underneath it, that title was hidden by a mat until Martin Button and his conservators, once again, in preparing one of his great exhibitions, saw the title, and the title was God Speaking to Adam. Well, this is, you can call it what you want, and Blake can change his mind about what it means, but he can't change the iconography, no more than Humpty Dumpty can change the meaning of words. It's still Elijah. It still functions that way, but he repurposes it, or he calls it God speaking to Adam. There's no image in the Bible with God or Yahweh with horses, let alone a flaming chariot. But what happens with people reading these illustrations as though they form a narrative, they assume that Chariot of Fire was God judging Adam in 1795, when it wasn't. In 1795, we can see clearly Blake still had Elijah in mind. He changes his mind, which he's allowed to do, but much later. So assuming that he had a plan, like Anthony Blunt and so many others do, is to misunderstand the process. And here's that process. This white line we're looking at is the outline on the matrix that Blake has drawn, and he's painting within the lines. I mean, this is indicating where he's putting paint. And we can see very clearly what he's doing. He's taking this drawing here. He's going to open this up. And he opens it up in the secondary drawing that he's going to transfer. And then he's going to go over that graphite with pen and ink on millboard, which is not going to print. And that's his first painting on the millboard. So you can see he is painting. These are to painting what the relief etchings are to manuscript and drawings. He's using the same tools, brushes and paint, and the same performance. This is that paint printed. It reticulates on the paper. And of course, it is blots and blurs until you come in and you organize it with outline. You have enough ink or color here, a thick water-based color to pull another impression. And there's your second impression, diminished because there's that much less color. And again, you come in and you can bring it out. The colors now are too diminished to get a third pull. And so when Blake takes it, prints it again, he cleans the matrix and he paints it up anew, and you have a third impression, not a third pull. And so you can see what Blake is doing. He's blots and blurs, a loaded brush, going into it and finding form and bringing it out. Some thought that this little print here was the trial proof and the beginning of the series, the set, the selection of prints of the group was this one, Pity. And no, it looks that way. This looks like a nice, the image here tells us this is probably how he worked, but that's not what the material evidence tells us. What this is telling us is this is resolved in this drawing. He resolves it by bringing this down, enlarging the horse. Aesthetically, he solves the problems raised by this one. When it comes to this, it's a shallow relief etching. And so this can't go. This can't go to Pity, which is on millboard. This is clearer to see it. This is a discrete event. This is a drawing in the portfolio. Remember this here? Well, there we see it again, right here. So we have a relief plate. This is a digital recreation of that relief plate. And it's a failed, this is a failed experiment. It works on the small scale of, you know, 3.5 by 5 inches, but it doesn't work when it's enlarged. This is very discordant, the reticulated against the flat. And so if this were his first, if this were a really a trial and not a failed or an failed experiment, but actual trial for the large color prints, Blake is acting incoherently. He would be working in metal with that plateau style of delineating form, and then go over here to gesso and millboard, only to go back to relief, low relief etching, and then from there back to millboard. So it doesn't make any sense. So here we have Blake in 1795 preparing four drawings: Pitty, Albion Rose, Elijah, and Newton. And he's going to create four small independent drawings, an experiment. And these two were meant for that copper plate, but they were taken out because he really liked what he was doing here, printing colors planographically. And he decides to take those quarters that were designed for Newton and Elijah and do a new illuminated book using the technique that Albion Rose taught him. And so these leave that cue and join the cue that becomes the large color prints. And this experiment is more successful in color printing and is teaching him something that you have to put color everywhere on the impression, and he can use a very thin line. This is what he's doing. He's learned that all he needs is a thin line. He does not to paint. He doesn't need that line to transfer it as outline. There's the outline he can reimpose. I'm going to run through these two because this is very exciting. This is what you read when you read the Song of Los. This is actually what Blake had created. And this is done at the same time he's working in landscape format for the monoprints. And he used one copper plate and then another copper plate matching it. And he finishes the Continental Prophecies, Africa and Asia. What are these? Is it a scroll? Is it a panel? I've never seen anything like this. I've recreated them to see what they would have been like if he printed them. But what he did when he printed them, he masked half of the plate under the rolling press so he could take a landscape format and reconvert it to page format, portrait format. And then he added four monoprints from millboard. So this is the most unorthodox illuminated book of all. It's a combination of metal and millboard and color printing, exactly the kind he's doing in the monoprints. And you see, and I'll stop there. And there's a few more, if there's time later in our discussion, that I can show if they're pertinent to our discussion. Okay?
Marvelous. Thank you. Thank you so much for, again, such a rich presentation, such fantastic imagery, and actually in both presentations, I'm reminded in both books, I mean, we're really asked to kind of look closely, to think about questions of technique, and to kind of almost look at the grain of the paper and the grain of the image, and in such a quite a demanding way, but in a way which is also incredibly kind of enjoyable and visually alluring as well. So thank you both for your presentations. I've got questions and thoughts, but there are questions lined up, quite specific questions for both speakers. There's also a few questions about whether this is being recorded and whether it'll be available down the line. And I think I can confirm it will be later in the spring. It'll be posted online. So keep an eye on the website and you can return to this evening's presentations in the future. But I mean, can I ask you both, just to kind of start the conversation really, about with Catesby, with Blake, they're very different artists, they're in different centuries, they're working in very different contexts, but for both of them, they're turning to print. I mean, do you have, just to kind of encapsulate, what does print as a medium mean for these individuals? Why turn to print? Henrietta, maybe it's a more straightforward answer with Catesby than Blake.
Yeah, well, I think after Joseph's presentation, definitely simpler with Catesby, because he was using etching to reproduce his drawings. So it was definitely a reproductive process for him, although we have seen that it wasn't straightforwardly reproductive, partly because for him, I think this is the crucial thing for him, was that the etching stage, partly because it was done by himself rather than being handed over to another artist, continued to be a creative stage.
Yeah.
He goes on creating until the very moment that he hands his etched, his copper plates over to the printer. And so all these extra little details and so on carry on. So you can hardly let go, and then finally he submits it to the printer. So what I want to reiterate is that both his painting, drawing and painting stage, and his etching stage, his printing stage, were almost sort of equated in terms of originality, to use that loaded word, but creativity. Yeah. Whereas other artists might have handed, and as he originally hoped to do, might have just simply handed over the drawings to a printer, and then that was the end of what they were doing, but not so for Catesby.
Yeah. That was very striking. I mean, introducing or talking about craftsmanship, but also that it's that kind of investment in print as a creative medium, which actually I kind of started to think about Blake rather unexpectedly at that point. Joe, would you like to?
No, that's exactly right. I caught that in your book, and I outlined it. This sounds like Blake. Blake takes that idea further, and because he can. He can take it as far as any printer ever has, because he is his own printer. He has a rolling press, and he uses the rolling press as a tool. He's actually experimenting with his press on what he can do to create these very interesting visual effects with color coming off of copper or coming off of millboard onto paper. And so he can be experimenting all the way to that point of the process. No other printmaker in his day was doing that. They might hold on to it as long as they could until the publisher or the printer said, hey, we need that. We got to go to press. Blake could. Also, Blake would have greatly admired Catesby's ability to render the drawing as exactly and as detailed as he has. Blake was a professional engraver. When the assignment called for a detailed reproduction of another person's drawing, whether it was his friend of his flaxman or Fuseli or just for the publishers, he did that, and he could do that, and he took pride in doing that. That was what the job called for. But when he's working on his own, when he's inventing and executing an original print, he can take as many liberties as he wants, and he does approach the print medium as an artist, that this is not a exact repeatable image. He's not even tied to his own models or the image on the plate itself. He will take liberties, and he does so all his life. When he returns to a print, he may reinterpret it, he may reburnish it, but the impression is not going to look like the one he had printed much earlier. And that's a whole different mind that you don't see in other contemporary printmakers.
Great. I'm going to start drawing. There's a few questions lined up here. Start drawing on these questions and feeding them through to you. There's actually two questions which are related, both for Henrietta. One is anonymous, which you're welcome to do, of course. Why is Catesby important in the history of natural history illustration? Why is he important in the history of natural history illustration? And actually, I think it kind of links with this, a question from John Hinks about whether you know if Thomas Bewick was familiar with Catesby's work. And John says he thinks he can detect some similarities.
Interesting about Bewick. I haven't thought of that, and possibly, yes, something I will look into, but I have to admit I haven't explored that, but it's quite possible. Why was he important? Well, I think he broke away from the idea of static illustrations of natural history. He was still quite early on in the process, to wit, he's looking to Barlow to try and get away from the profile prose. He was struggling with the idea that he wanted to bring movement into his illustration. He is important, very evidently, for the interaction he shows. I use the word ecological and environmental, which of course were not concepts that were used at the time, or thought about in the time. But he was a pioneer in the sense that he went into the field and drew animals in interaction with plants. So this was a completely new thing, apart from the evident model of Maria Sibylla Marion, who did it very specifically with insects, but Catesby tried to show the plenitude of natural history in this way. So he was not an armchair naturalist or illustrator working from home. He went out into the field and then he tried to convey what he'd seen in the wild in
Okay, thank you. There's a question here, which I think was directed to Henrietta originally, but I think I'll ask to both of you. And there's a basic kind of factual question here, which is about what was the year the copyright law and engraving was instated? But I think out of that comes a kind of larger question about authorship and the kind of the right of a printmaker or the right of a creator to kind of profit or benefit from the images that they create. So if one or both of you can answer the straightforward question about when copyright law for engravings applied, and then also think perhaps a little bit about how your artists relate to that question of copyright or of authorship in the medium of print.
Henrietta, you mentioned Hogarth's. I'm not sure how much effect it had in the first generation. They're still fighting that war today. We're still fighting over copyright. I had to deal with that in building the Blake Archive. It was very difficult. It still is. The copyright often is contract law. It's not even a copyright because things are in public domain now. But in the 18th century, it was a radical idea that I own the rights of my image and you don't, and you have to pay me something if you reproduce it. It gets very complicated actually in the 19th century when you begin to have photo mechanical reproductions and people, it's a new laws are passed basically for wealthy owners to protect valuable property. That was what we see in the 1870s and onward. But earlier in the prints, Blake didn't pay much attention to that. But Gatesby needed to. I mean, this was his bread and butter. He had to save. This was his intellectual capital.
Great. That leads us, Henrietta. Do you want to add anything in terms of? I mean, again, it's the question of why print, but it's clear there's a kind of sort of commercial operation, or it's about publicity and making a name, isn't it?
I think that Hogarth's law was, as I mentioned, it came in while Catesby was halfway through his book. I don't think he struggled with these problems as Hogarth did. Hogarth was the one who really, producing his original designs, and then the hacks in the print shops would busily do a sort of version or whatever, and then sell it for sixpence, and he was selling his for 2 guineas. So, I mean, there was a real commercial thing there going for him. I think Catesby was just ploughing on with what he needed to do, and he did it, and then he died shortly afterwards. I don't think he was himself thinking that his work would be plagiarized. Of course, there were many artists after him who were influenced by him. But I think I was more interested in the idea of him, as it were, lifting other artists' images with impunity. I mean, in they go. But I think it's for him, it's, and there was nobody then to say, don't do that, or how dare you, or I mean, some of the artists were dead anyway, but I think it's because with him, even though at core he's a naturalist, the artist in him and the artistry in him can't, he's as inspired by art as he is by the natural world. So it all, there's a very fine line between what he's actually seeing, if you like, ad vivum, and describing for the world to see, and how then it becomes changed in as he looks at something because he's seen some other image. And so a lot of it is unconscious, I think, for Catesby. So I don't think there's a sort of protectiveness either by him or by the rest of the world guarding other images. That's my reading of it anyway. I mean, we are talking about a very early stage, early 18th century. By the end, by Blake's time, of course, things.
So do you want to come back in there? Yeah.
Yeah, one comment that I noted again in your remarkable book is that Gatesby saw drawing as the art of seeing. It's what moved you from looking to seeing. It brought you to a whole nother level of understanding. Illumination is exactly the right word. It is shedding light. It is not just limning print. It is understanding and seeing it more clearly than you can any other way. Art is the means by which we see and understand the world. Blake perfectly understood that. Even though he would say one must see through the eye, not with the eye, it's still recognizing the power of art to teach us how to see, and knowing it affects our perception. And from there, you can go in all kinds of directions, visionary art, Blake's idea of infinity in a grain of sand. But it's also a very central thesis of romanticism, particularly in Wordsworth, what Catesby is doing, seeing the sublime beauty in the minutiae of the world. I was very struck by that he would find insects or the things that are, in Wordsworthian terms, is the everyday and ordinary that we don't see, either because they're too small or we're too busy or we're too familiar with them. And his attention to them really brings out information that's all around us that we don't know. That's a very romantic idea from a Wordsworthian and a Blakean idea, the infinity in a grain of sand.
I feel like we're just getting started. This could go in all sorts of wonderful directions, but I'm conscious of time, and we need to kind of move towards closing for the evening. I've got questions lined up, specific questions, but a question each for both of you, just to try and kind of round the evening off. Question from an anonymous contributor, but for Henrietta, are there any color palette notes in Catesby's drawings? It was interesting, yeah, because that question of working towards the colored image.
Yes, in two of his versos, we see him annotating the drawing with color notes. They are only very sort of primitive notes. They say yellow and green. I think that was more him trying out a method of shorthand method in the field rather than, I mean, as well as taking his paintbrushes into the field. He sometimes used this method of recording colors by naming them. We don't have a color chart. It's occurred to me that he might have used a color chart, as we know some artists of the period did and later. But there's nothing surviving that tells us how he, that anything about his palette, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you. That, move around to Joseph, a question from John Hinks. Fascinating talk, thank you. I mean, there's lots of that in the chat as well, if you want to look for it, of course. I've just lost it, hang on, sorry. Could you please explain how you identify where an impression or pull is missing?
Yes, that's a series of clues that come from knowing the pattern of production from the beginning, and we saw always two, and then provenance records. There's a reference to a work that we don't have, and I've done a good deal of work here in signing Blake, this article on when Blake signed something, that was signifying a sale. And we have nine monoprints that are signed, and we don't know what to make of them. Well, yes, we do. That's evidence that he sold them to someone. We just don't know who the collectors were. We think he sold only to Thomas Butts, and Butts did have 11 of the 12. But there's another 10 that were owned in Blake's lifetime between 1805 and 1810. And I think I make a good case that's those works that are signed were in collections. And then they start coming out of collections when those people die and their descendants put them up. We start seeing that in 1850s. Okay, yeah. Just before Gilchrist's biography in 1863. So when you combine the information from provenance, the provenance of each work, and the mode of production, it points to four missing works.
Yeah.
Newton, there's a strong case to make that there's an impression of Newton missing from the 1795 printing, one of Satan as well. And the other two we already suspect, Elohim and Nebuchadnezzar, we thought they're untraced, and that's how they're listed in the catalog raisonné. But these other two were doubtful, although Martin Butlin does acknowledge that that is a possibility from reading a list from 1827 in which they're on. So they had to exist by that time, but I've shown that there were copies in these other collections because those are the signed copies we have today. So those were out, they weren't around in 1827. If they're in someone's collection in 1810, Mrs. Blake no longer had them to sell, yet we have a list of what she does have to sell. So it's clues like that. It's a detective story.
So they may be out there somewhere. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Right? Yes.
They'll turn up on Antiques Roadshow.
Road, exactly.
Well, you never know. You never know. Well, thank you both. We were due to run till 5:30. We could run for another 2 hours, I know, but we've still got just about 100 people with us. But we should say a big thank you, firstly, to Joseph and Henrietta for such fantastic presentations. And thank you and congratulations for such amazing books as well. I mean, your talks this evening really kind of focused on, you know, the investment in print and the investment in the graphic image as a kind of experimental medium, as a creative medium. And that's communicated so well in the books and the form of the books. As I say, they're so richly illustrated and there are images repeated and you focus in and move out and you juxtapose images so well, and there's a real kind of visual experience going through these books. So a huge recommendation to all our readers, listeners tonight, to also become readers of your books. So thank you for your presentations. Thank you also to Shauna and Danny for getting things set up this evening and looking after us so well on the technical side. I believe that there are more questions than we could go through this evening, but I think we will be capturing them, and you'll be welcome to email through, and we can pass on questions and comments to tonight's panel in due course. The next event in this series is next week, 9th of March. That's on aesthetic encounters. It's dealing with art, craft, and design in the 19th century. So I hope you will be able to join us again for that next week. In the meantime, just once more, thank you, Joseph Viscomi. Thank you, Henrietta McBurney, for such wonderful presentations. And thank you, everybody, for attending and listening and feeding through your questions and comments this evening. So good night for now.
Bye-bye.